Hi everyone, welcome to Knowledge is Power. I'm Wanda Miller, I'm the host, and my guest is on his way. He's in transit right now. He got a little delayed, so this isn't the first time this has happened, so we can get through this. I'm going to have Mike Wasikovich on this week. He's half of the husband and husband couple, Mike and Glenn Wasikovich. I was hoping Glenn would come, but something came up and Glenn can't make it. Before I get started, I want to read a little note that Demi sent to me last week. As you know, we had Demi on last week, and she was nice enough to come on and share all her books of her different authors that she's been publishing. So that was really, really nice of her. And we also talked to Dr. Sherry Kim, and I'm going to give you an update on Sherry in just a few minutes. But first, I just want to read you what Demi sent to me, which is really nice. She said, "Wanda, thanks so much for having me on the show last week. It was like spending an hour with an old young friend. Cheers, Demi." So thank you, Demi, for sending this nice little thank you note. That was really sweet of her to be considerate. And I mean, because last week Ace wasn't here. Ace is back this week, so we were pretty much just trying to do the show by the seat of our pants, which isn't unusual either. But moving on to Dr. Sherry Kim, and last week, those of you who tuned in, and for those who didn't, I'll update everyone. Dr. Kim is a psychologist on 18 South George Street, and Sherry does a lot of work with vulnerable populations. She works with victims of human trafficking. She works with women at the Jefferson Women's Shelter. She has a policy that mental health care for everyone, regardless of their ability to pay. So even if you don't have insurance or you're someone's homeless, they can come in and they can see Sherry or one of the other therapists. And every Wednesday between the hours of 10 and 2, they have a walk-in clinic where you can come in and you can get help with, you know, if you need some counseling, you can get that. You can also get some help maybe finding a therapist. If you're going into crisis, they can help refer that. So they really do a lot of good for the community. And Sherry does a great deal for the community. And it would be a real shame if she would have to close her doors. The reason that she is struggling financially right now is because it's very complicated. I'm not even sure I understand everything that's going on, but in a nutshell, she is not getting reimbursed by medical assistance. The Department of Human Services is not reimbursing her for services that she's provided. They have, I think, something like a $16,000 deficit right now, and she does have a GoFundMe. Can you put that up, Ace, for me, the GoFundMe? It's www.gofundme.com/keepusopen. So far, she has around $260 in the GoFundMe, fund, and it would be nice if she got even more, because it's really is. I mean, I talked to Sherry before the show, and she unfortunately last week she called in and talked a little bit. She couldn't do that this week because of other commitments, but Sherry expressed a lot of concern, not so much for herself, but for the staff at her agency, and even more than the staff at her agency, people that are clients, people that have nowhere else to go. Where will they go if she closes down? So this is a passion of hers. And you know, anyone out there who has ever done any kind of charity work or volunteerism, there's certain things that are near and dear to our hearts, and this is very much near and dear to Sherry's heart. I lived last week with, I have my friend here, Stinky Skunk, and he still has a little Bernie button. And what I talked about last week was the fact that Bernie ran a whole campaign on pretty much nickels and dimes. People donated a dollar, they donated 50 cents, they donated $1.20, $1.59. Whatever they could donate, they donated. And he got pretty far on those donations. So I'm thinking, you know, if a presidential candidate can do that, I think we as a community can do that for Sherry and help her keep this open, because it's a really good resource. You have to understand the ramifications of people that aren't treated for mental health issues. So many things just spiral out of control. You know, someone has a mental health issue, and then if they don't get treated for that, they can start self-medicating, which means the substance abuse. And we have the opioid epidemic, the heroin epidemic right now. You know, unresolved mental health issues can contribute to that. Then we get into the criminal justice system. We have jails that are overflowing now. And, you know, there are a lot of mentally ill people that are being incarcerated because we no longer have state-funded institutions. So it's just a nasty, vicious cycle. And this is why it's so important to be proactive rather than reactive, and to keep agencies like Sherry's open. Kevin Schreiber's office has been helping. They've been every day. They've had contact with Sherry, and Sherry's had contact with them. She said that there's been a little bit of movement, but she still can't bill. She still can't bill for certain services, and it's really hurting her. She's a small agency. If it was a bigger agency, they might be able to absorb that cost, but because she's small, it's really difficult for her. The other thing that I could suggest is, besides donating, you know, the 50 cents, the dollar, whatever you have, I mean, everyone, you know, even those of us that are on really, really fixed, tight budgets, we can find a dollar, we can find 50 cents. You know, it's if you're, instead of going and buying that Starbucks coffee, or, you know, going to the 250 movie over at Queen Street, donate it. Think about donating it to Sherry, because she would really appreciate it. The other thing that I can suggest is to go to the PA Department of Human Services. Their number, I believe this is their main number. This is what I came up with, so I'm not sure if this is right, but at least if you can call and express concern that they are not paying their providers, because it's not only Sherry that's being affected, there's a lot of providers that are being affected right now. The number, Ace, do you have that one up to the 1-800? It's 1-800-692-7462, and that is the number to the PA Department of Human Services. So if you can help Sherry out, please help her out. I know she'd appreciate it. I know a lot of clients would appreciate it. Her staff will appreciate it. It's just, you know, we need to rally together. We need to support each other in the community. That's how change happens. That's how problems get resolved. So just, you know, keep that in mind going forward. And, you know, if you can donate, please donate. The next thing I'm going to go over is the Golden Hammer Award. And the Golden Hammer Award, since we're just talking about Kevin Schreiber, I'm going to give the Golden Hammer this week to Kevin Schreiber. And I'm going to give it to him because he has supported something called the PA Able Savings Program. Now, this is a program, and I'll read to you what this is about. But basically, this came about because if you've ever dealt with any kind of social services, or you have a loved one that had to go into long-term care living, or they had to go on medical assistance, you know, they can't have anything. I mean, it's really, they can have basically nothing to qualify for these programs. So if someone got, you know, $5,000 inheritance from some obscure relative, they would be disqualified for services. Well, what the PA Able Act did is it allowed people to have a little higher income. So I'm going to read to you exactly what this means. This PA Able Savings Program will help families with disabilities. In April, Governor Tom Wolf signed into law the Able Act, which stands for Achieving a Better Life Experience. This new program will allow families to ensure that relatives with a disability are taken care of by providing them with a savings account without jeopardizing eligibility for important programs that they and their loved ones depend on. I know this is Kevin Schreiber's. This is from his newsletter. So he's saying he was proud to vote for this legislation, and I applaud him for voting for that legislation, which allows the savings accounts to be used for a wide range of disability-related expenses, including health care, housing, and transportation. Under this new law, benefits of the program include save up to $14,000 per year. That's wonderful. Tax-free growth, use of the account to pay for a wide range of disability-related expenses, federal and state income tax-free withdrawals when used for qualified disability expenses, exemption from Pennsylvania inheritance tax. I mean, it's just a wonderful act, and it's just amazing that they signed this into law, because usually these kind of things get buried. But this one made it through, it got signed, and it's wonderful. It's going to help so many people now. It says one of the most vital aspects of the ABLE program is that savings are excluded from eligibility determinations for many government-related benefits. This means Supplemental Security Income, SSI, medical assistance, and other disability and health benefits cannot be taken away because of ABLE savings. For more information, please visit www.pa529.com/ABLE or contact Representative Schreiber's office. So again, that's www.pa529.com/ABLE. And I'm sure Representative Schreiber has a number here that I can give to you. Oh, here we go. His district office is 848-9595. That's easy. 848-9595. So that is Representative Schreiber's office. And of course, you can always stop by too, because he's right over there by the Revs now. Next on the agenda is I didn't even do a rusty nail this week, because what I decided to talk about this week for the worst case scenario, it just stinks the whole way around. It stinks. Rusty nails just doesn't cover it. What's happening is there is a scam going around now. It's an email scam, and I actually got this, and I looked into it, did a little research on it, and I found out that it's a pretty major thing, and it's a pretty big deal. And apparently a lot of people are getting scammed, and they're getting harmed through this thing. But what's happening is you will get an email. Like in my case, I got an email. I have a Gmail account. So I got an email, and it said the heading was "From Me to Me," which is strange to begin with. So they got my email address. They're spoofing my email address, first of all. And they're sending the email from me to me. And it has in big letters, warning, you have a child predator is in your neighborhood. Beware, predator alert. This is what you can do to make yourself safe. Now, this email, apparently the link inside of it is it's a real organization, but the organization has nothing to do with the email. So they're spoofing the organization as well. So if you click on that link, you're going to get into all kinds. They're phishing for information. You could get a virus in your phone or in your computer. I've read over and over again, these were warnings from Consumer Affairs, from Attorney General's offices, from news stations. They stress, do not click links or respond. Just do not do it. This is what they suggest, is if you really want to know if there's a child sex offender in your area, that you can go to the United States Department of Justice National Sex Offender website. And Ace, can you put that up for me, please? It's www.nsopw.gov, and that is the only true sex offender information website. Those other ones, they're not legitimate, they're not credible. Do not open them up. You'll get yourself in a lot of trouble. They are using scare tactics, which, you know, is not uncommon. So that, just be really aware of that. And they also said that if you receive any kind of deceptive spam email, not just this particular one, but any of them. What you do is forward that email to, can you get that one up? Thanks. It's to spam@uce.gov. And that is the Federal Trade Commission uses spam in this database to pursue law enforcement actions against those sending deceptive emails. So that is another thing that you can do. You could also go to the Attorney General's office. You can call the Federal Trade Commission if you want more information, but just don't click on that because it's not legitimate. The other scam that I came across myself as well is you'll get an email that says if there's something wrong with your account, your account has been compromised, and if you don't contact this number or email or whatever, that your account will be suspended and you'll basically lose all your information. Well, I got an email like that. It's very persuasive, very realistic. I ended up looking for a number to Yahoo, found a number online to Yahoo, and it turns out that that number isn't even connected to Yahoo. It's connected to another scam. So these scam artists, they're getting more and more sophisticated. They're getting more and more aggressive. They're getting bolder and bolder, and you just have to be very, very careful. So if you get an email like that, don't believe that either. Yahoo even says on one of their links that they don't have a phone number, and they will never take money for security either. So if you're having a security issue, they aren't going to make you pay to get that fixed. So I think here comes our guest. And I just finished, so you can come in and sit down and
I thought we start at 6.
Yeah, we start at 5:30.
Oh, yeah, I'm all off. It's like, so yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, I introduced you. Right. I introduced Mike. Those of you may have seen the show. Him and his husband were on, I don't know, maybe a month ago or so.
About a month back.
And we talked about LGBT rights. Right. We talked about the election. I have Stinky Skunk with Bernie. And since that time, Mike is now seeking higher office. He has some other things going on. So where do you want to start?
Your show, you start. Tell me where we're starting.
Okay,
so,
well,
I'm a little late.
Do you want to start talking about, I think one of the things that with this election coming up, you know, we have these two candidates, and really, you know, we're kind of trying to figure out what they stand for and what their platform is. Both of them, I know neither one of them really have a real good strong platform for LGBT rights.
I would probably say that Clinton probably has the strongest one. Mm-hmm. Granted, she has in the past not been as supportive on LGBT rights. Now she's, you know, evolved on the LGBT rights. So it's a hard candidate to choose right now. But I mean, if I, you know, a member of the LGBT community, I'm not going to vote for Trump. There's no way in hell. he, just like what he said about the black community, oh, vote for me, what do you got to lose? It's kind of how he's treating the LGBT community. Mm-hmm. And then he goes ahead and picks as a running mate the most anti-LGBT, you know, running mate you could probably find anywhere in the United States. So I, honestly, If you know, I had to pick one or the other, it's going to have to be Clinton.
Well, I'm not LGBT, but I'll tell you, I would not vote for Trump. There's no way.
No.
There's just no way. The nastiness, the horrible things that he says, all of the, I mean, it's women, it's everybody.
He insults every demographic that the Republicans need to win. The only one he hasn't insulted yet are the white males, so that's probably coming. Would not surprise me. Better make sure that this is turned off.
Okay. So, last time you were here, too, you were talking about some legislation that you're trying to. How's that going?
It kind of got a little stalled. Mm-hmm. Got a little pushback from other council members. They weren't quite sure how to go about, is it violating the Constitution? And they kept bringing up, is it violating the Constitution? Mm-hmm. And, you know, the only thing you could say back is, well, if you're violating the Constitution for one set of people, you're violating the Constitution, period.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's, you know, that was, as soon as we got past that, then we were able to move on a little bit more. Our solicitor, the lawyer, he, you know, he's like, hey, I'm supportive of it. He's like, we can go down to the courthouse and I can show you records of areas in York County, and I didn't know that, you know, this was like this, but where he says that you could find that say, you know, no black people are allowed. You don't need to apply in this area. Jews need not apply over here. Mm-hmm. You know, certain demographics need not apply in certain areas. I know the one area is right up by the country club, I believe. Mm-hmm. He's like, these were from the, you know, the 40s and the 50s and stuff like that. He's like, it's changed. They've obviously removed those. You don't have those stipulations anymore. But, you know, he was supportive of it. He said, hey, you know, and, you know, he also didn't believe that there was anything he thought that the state had something to say, hey, no, you can't do this to these people. Mm-hmm. And he pulled out his cell phone, did a quick search, and 20 seconds, he went, wow, there, you legitimately could be thrown out of your apartment. You could be denied services and all mm-hmm. that stuff. So he's very supportive of it. I feel like I may have the, including myself, the other three Democrats supporting it. The mm-hmm. three Republicans, I don't believe, will support it. Because mm-hmm. I got the religious argument. I got the, you know, a lot of us have faith. We have to look to our faith and things like that. And I'm like, well, we're not at church council.
Right.
We're at city council, which affects, or borough council, rather, which affects everyone. It's mm-hmm. not just, you know, Christians, Catholics, Jews, Muslims. It's atheists, too. And they were, you know, kind of pushing back on mm-hmm. the religious aspect of everything, so.
Yeah. So, for those people that don't know exactly what's going on, can you just kind of explain exactly what the legislation is that you're trying to put together?
It would be an ordinance that would give fair housing. So the apartment complex, Buttonwood, that's out in Hellam, mm-hmm. they couldn't deny someone. It, you know, pretty much the LGBT community is the last class of individuals mm-hmm. fighting for rights. And, you know, if a transgender person wants to move in and they look at them and say, oh, no. Why? Well, you're transgender. We don't like that. Well, then they could come to the borough and they could say, they denied me housing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It would really, it would affect, you know, yeah, it's a small group of people in Hellam. There's not a whole, you know, the LGBT community out there isn't very large, but these people still worry about that. They mm-hmm. look and go, I can lose my house, you know. What about public accommodations? What if there's a hotel that gets put up? Can they deny me from, renting a room or things of that nature? So it helps with the public accommodations as well. Obviously, there's a religious exemption. So if you are a member of a organization that does not approve of the LGBT lifestyle, you're exempt from it. You don't have to marry someone. You know, that's the big thing. Mm-hmm. Oh, well, then you're going to make me marry them. No, no, we're not. Because you're a religious entity. You can do your own thing. You can mm-hmm. marry, you know, man and woman. That's all you want to do.
Mm-hmm.
But the mayor can't look and say, I don't do that. I don't marry, you know, two women, two mm-hmm. men. I don't do that. So that's going to, you know, help them out as well.
I'm just amazed that we're in 2016.
And it feels like we're in 1916.
Yeah, we're still having these discussions where we're so worried about what people do in their bedrooms.
Well, we're worried about what people do in their bedrooms. We're worried about how they dress. We're worried about, you know, women entering the workforce. Should they make equal pay for equal mm-hmm. work? Those are just common sense things. Like, I don't understand how legislators in Harrisburg or any state capital or even the federal level could say, you know what? You're a woman, you're doing equal work as that man, but I'm going to pay you, 70 cents on the dollar?
Yeah, something like that.
And I'm
like
going to give him that mm-hmm. full dollar. Give me a break. I mean, come on. Equal pay, equal work. Just be done.
Yeah, it just doesn't make sense. I mean, next week, I'm going to have, do you know Carla, Christopher?
Yes.
Do you know Carla? Okay, Carla's going to be on next week.
Woohoo!
And Carla and I are going to talk about race relations.
It's...
So, you know, we're gonna start that discussion because no one else seems to want to.
It's a little bit faux pas. It's, you don't want to mess around with that because then it's, you know, you might say something wrong or, you know, mm-hmm. I'm a white guy. I might say something that's highly offensive to this community or that community. So you really got to, you know, walk on eggshells. But then sometimes you just got to go, okay, let's talk. Mm-hmm. And if I say something wrong, you say, hey, that's wrong. Mm-hmm. And we just keep talking. Because it's the only way we're going to fix these problems is if we open dialogue and we move on.
Mm-hmm. And that's what her and I, that's the conclusion we came to. And I, you know, I had a discussion with an African-American friend, and she started talking about white privilege. And she said, oh, I'm sorry. And I said, no, it's a fact. You know, and this is why we have to stop this censoring ourselves as long as we're doing this in a respectful way.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I have friends that I'll say African American community, and they'll say, mm-hmm. no, it's black community.
Yeah.
Okay, the black community. Then I'll have other friends that say, no, it's African American. And I'm mm-hmm. just like, you know, I don't know what's what. And it's like, I stick with one. I normally just say the black community.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Hispanic community, there's so many different communities dealing with that. You know, you have your Cuban, your Puerto Rican, you have Mexican, you have mm-hmm. so many, and I just lump them all in, and I know that's terrible. That is just so terrible for me to do, and I'm just like, but what can you do?
Well, I think pretty much that's what Trump's going to do when he builds the wall.
I've had so many arguments with people about that at work, that they're like, well, he's going to build a wall. He's going to pay for it.
Yeah.
And the best analogy I can come up with, that's like saying, you know, you need a new roof on your house, mm-hmm. and you're going to go ahead and put the roof on, mm-hmm. and then when they give you the bill, you're going to say, no, my neighbor's going to take it,
mm-hmm.
and he's going to pay it? Bull crap. I call bull crap on that. So.
Yeah.
And there's so many people out there that believe that he's going to put this wall up, and it's just going to... You know, it's going to solve immigration. No, it won't. It'll just make matters worse.
Yeah, it will make matters worse. And again, we need to be informed consumers. We need to be informed voters. We need to be informed of what our civic duty is. And I know, you know, the last time you were here, we had a really good discussion on this. And it's absolutely right, though, because people are not looking at the facts of the matter.
Well, it's mainstream media. It's mm-hmm. Shiny object over here. We're doing something wrong over mm-hmm. here. Don't look over here, but look at this shiny object. And so many people go, oh, shiny object. And that's all they focus mm-hmm. on. And that's all they want to talk about. And it's like, but what about the big picture? And they can't see that big picture.
Yeah.
And, you know, mainstream media, when, you know, you do, when I go to the gym, I go to Planet Fitness. Mm-hmm. So I have my three news right here, CNN, Fox, and MSN.
Mm-hmm.
It's all the same. All the same, and they're all saying pretty much exactly the same thing. And I sit there and I stare at them. I'm like, wow, whoever owns these, they're really just keeping us low information voters. So then mm-hmm. I got to turn to, you know, the Young Turks. I got to turn to any other, you know, blogs and things of that nature mm-hmm. to really... you know, pick up the news and pick up what's going on.
Yeah. And are you still seeking higher office?
I'm kind of hemming and hawing with that. I don't know what I wanted to do. George's group, we had a meeting last week, 2 weeks ago. Yeah, I don't know if you got the email.
I didn't get a chance to go to that one last week because I had another commitment.
But we started discussing about that, and there were some people that are in my area that were like, what's your name? I'm going to write your name in for mm-hmm. Keith Gillespie. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, well, it's three people, but hey, it's three people.
Yeah.
I thought, you know, that seat was up next year, and I was going to put my name in, run for that. But he's up this year, so the only way I could do it would be a write-in campaign, which is very difficult to do because it's, you know, it's a lot of work.
Yeah.
So now I have talked to Glenn about it, and I'm like, should I try? Shouldn't I try? And he's like, well, give it a shot. What's it going to happen? You know, what's it going to hurt?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm kind of talking with George quite a bit, and he's giving me some pointers, you know, how to get a writing campaign, you know, off the ground and running. So, mm-hmm.
Well, and Josh Burkholder, who is running against Scott Perry.
Right.
He did a write-in.
Yes, he did a write-in for the primary. I don't mm-hmm. think there was anyone running? in the primary with him?
I'm not sure, but I know he needed like 1,000 votes and he got more than that.
Okay.
So, okay. And he's now, I think he's been endorsed by Keystone Progressives. Keystone Progressives.
There's Keystone Progressives and a whole lot of organizations that sound the same.
Yeah. So there are a lot of, and that's another thing, like we've talked about on this show, about how people are eliminated from running for office because they don't have the big bucks, because they don't have the name, or they don't have, they're not like, you but know, certain, you know, certain.
I study this in school, yeah. Right now, you know, you need the name recognition, you need the money, you mm-hmm. need, you know, party backing, you need all this stuff. And it's like, that's to your average individual who imagines running, that's very scary for them. Like, even for me, when I was thinking about running, I was like, wow, that's a lot of stuff. That's very scary. You know, you're really putting yourself out there. But it's just, it's so much, and just like, you don't need the money. Mm-hmm. With social media now, you could probably run a very effective campaign without spending a dime.
Mm-hmm.
There's so many people on Facebook, on Twitter, on Reddit, and other things where you could probably put your name out there and you'll find people who will, you know, who are in your district, who will vote for you, who are like, yeah, you know, I like this guy. You know, you go out and you can raise money. You can raise money via, you know, GoFundMe. There's a friend of mine who graduated Millersville last year, who is trying mm-hmm. to, or was trying to run for the Democrat, but they were kind of calling him and saying, it's not your time, you're not going to happen, mm-hmm. so don't run. And he's, I think, running as an independent right now, but I mean, he set mm-hmm. up a GoFundMe page to, you know, get yard signs, get, you know, literature, get all that stuff. There's so many ways to do it, and it's just, you just got to do it, and sometimes, you know, the benefits will pay out.
Mm-hmm. And you have to start, too. You have to start right. early, because you figure you may not win the first election, but that's sort of a warm-up for
right.
the next one.
Right, and that was something that George was talking about. He's yeah. like, you know, you try the write-in, but, you know, you can put in, we're coming for you in 2018.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm putting my name out there, but I'm coming for you in 2018.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, yeah, that would be a good, you know, kind of slogan to use, but, you know, that's the thing. You know, you got to get a name on a ballot or some kind of name recognition mm-hmm. and move from there.
Yeah. And for those of you who were talking about George is George Sanders, who is in Red Lion, and he's a really cool guy. And he was a big Bernie supporter, and so he has been continuing the momentum of Bernie's mm-hmm. of the movement of our revolution, right? And he has meetings off and on, and
right.
talks about the, you know, different, you know, a lot of community activism, a
yes.
lot of grassroots kind of activism.
He's really into the grassroots, into mm-hmm. that kind of thing, which, you know, that's how you win an election, is, mm-hmm. you know, the common person, the common man mm-hmm. is how you win the election. You're not going to win the election by getting, you know, the endorsements of, you know, multimillionaires and huge corporations. Yeah, they'll be able to, you know, tell their employees about you, but really the grassroots is where it's at. And he's really focusing on that. I mean, currently we're trying to figure out a name for the group. Mm-hmm. We've been meeting at his wife's, the Red Brick Bakery and Tea Room.
Mm-hmm.
And, yes, we're trying to figure out a name for that group.
Yeah. Well, and it's the idea of starting from the bottom and building
yep.
up versus
yep.
from up and down.
Yep.
And there's really, you know, I know I've had last week Allison Cooper from the York Dispatch had a forum for those of us who are on the contributors board,
mm-hmm.
and there was and not one person, by the way, is voting for Trump out of the group. Even the Republican, the lone Republican, was like, I can't.
I don't know if I buy that.
So
there's so many Trump yard signs that I'm beyond amazed that I drive around and I just see Trump, 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 and I'm like, oh my God.
Yeah. Well, Carla was there. We had some really good people there, and we had this discussion. And, you know, one of the things that a lot of us were saying is that since Bernie dropped out, we don't really have somebody that we relate to.
Yeah. And Carla's probably seen it. On my Facebook, I had posted something that I was, you know, I was upset, I was angry, I was, mm-hmm. you know, you name every, you know, everything, and I was probably it. I was going through the stages of grief.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I've just come to the conclusion that, okay, Bernie's dropped out.
Mm-hmm.
Bernie's dropped out. He's in the past. I got to focus on the future. I got to look to see what's going to mm-hmm. happen. I don't trust Trump. Every progressive thing that we've mm-hmm. fought and won for, marriage equality, the affordable health care, you know, things of that nature will be dismantled under Trump.
Mm-hmm.
We will be back in the 1950s. I can't let that happen. I could vote for a third party.
Mm-hmm.
Gary Johnson, he doesn't know where Aleppo is, so his foreign policy is going to be a disaster. You know, I could vote for Jill Stein.
Mm-hmm.
I look at her stuff. She's an activist.
Mm-hmm.
In my opinion, activists don't make good politicians because they see the world as what they believe it is,
mm-hmm.
but there's a world that it actually is.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with activism. Activism is great. It gets the conversation moving, you know. You need the activists
mm-hmm.
and the politician. So I look at her and I go, I can't vote for her because she just, you know, she just doesn't have that confidence. So I had a big, long post, and I said, you know, I will support Clinton. I can probably side with her about 25% of the time.
Mm-hmm.
The other candidates I can't side with. So, yes, I will support Clinton. I'm not going to be her biggest and loudest cheerleader.
Mm-hmm.
Don't get me wrong. I still wish, you know, Bernie was in it. Really wish Bernie was in it.
Mm-hmm.
If he was in it, I'd be in a Bernie suit head to toe with a big old top hat. But she's really my only choice right now,
mm-hmm.
and in 4 years we'll see what she's done, and if, you know, it's really gone to pot, well, hopefully there's a Democrat to caucus against her. Maybe it'll be Bernie Sanders, maybe it'll be what's her name, Tulsa,
oh yeah,
Gifford,
yeah, I know.
Is that her name?
Yeah,
she's a congresswoman from Hawaii, I believe.
Yeah, I know who you're talking about.
You mm-hmm. know, maybe she'll run.
Yeah,
and that'd be awesome because that would
mm-hmm.
be legitimately carrying on Bernie's torch.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe Elizabeth Warren will run.
Mm-hmm.
I think she's having too much fun in the Senate.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know if you saw her and the Wells Fargo president.
No, I didn't see that. No.
Watch it. It's
mm-hmm.
classic. I was just like, wow, she's an attack dog. And she knows her stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe she'll run. You know, or maybe, you know, we're all worried about a Clinton presidency over nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe she will be a progressive. Maybe she will worry about the environment.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe she will take on the big banks. And then 4 years, we'll go, wow, we had nothing to worry about.
Mm-hmm.
Let's vote for her again. But right now, I can at least side with her on, you know, a quarter of the time. And right now, that's who my vote's going for.
Mm-hmm. Well, my personal opinion on her is, and you know, this is going way back when Bill was in office. You know, I think as a woman, I understand that. You know, I hear people all the time saying, well, she's not very personable. She's kind of, you know, she's withdrawn. She's sort of aloof. But if you look at the time period of when she rose to her current position,
mm-hmm.
that's, you know, you didn't, I mean, now it's a little bit better. But and there was a time when really women weren't in politics.
Right, right. And, you know, there was a time when, you know, the woman stayed at home
mm-hmm.
and baked cookies and took care of the kids. That's all she did. That was her job. We're not that anymore.
Right.
Clinton is that, you know, she wants to have privacy,
mm-hmm.
but she wants to be in the public. And it's a hard thing to juggle. Like,
mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm a borough councilman. I'm not really in the public, but, you know,
mm-hmm.
I do run my Facebook page, and then I run, I have a councilman, you know, my name, Helen
mm-hmm.
Burrow, page, and I have to watch what I post.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes I can be really angry, and, you know, I want to say something that's just really mean, but I got to look and go, I can't post that, because if somebody reads it, that could be offensive to X, Y, and Z, and
mm-hmm.
oh my, I gotta cool that down, and you know, I have to worry about that. I have to balance both of those, and I think she just wants to be, I want to be myself over here,
mm-hmm.
and nobody pay attention to me, but then I want the spotlight, and then everyone pay attention to me.
Mm-hmm.
But you're not gonna be able to have it both ways, so you're gonna have to kind of fuse the two together and figure out what's what. You know, she's not very personable. I don't really care if my politician's personable.
Mm-hmm.
I really don't. That's me. If she doesn't want to come over and, you know, have a beer with me, I don't care. I don't care. But, you know, they're just politicians that just, you know, people are like, oh, I want you to be able to have a pizza with me or have a beer or have this or have that. Mm-hmm. Really? Is that really what you want? Or do you want them to govern and give you awesome policies that's going to, you know, change your life for the better? Mm-hmm. Or do you want that beer? You got to balance it. Do you want the beer or do you want the policies that are going to make your life better? Are they going to bring jobs back to America? Are they going to, you know, raise the minimum wage? Are they going to give you a better standard of living? I want those things. Mm-hmm. The beer, I don't really care about. I don't. But that's just me.
Yeah. And I think, too, the latest... And it's just, I'm so sick of the sniping and the back and forth. And, you know, you have, like, two little kids on the playground. Yeah. And the latest with her and talking about the...
Basket of deplorables?
The basket of deplorables. And then she came out and apologized. And I read what she said. And she didn't actually call all of his supporters.
She said there were some. Yeah, that were she basket said, of like, deplorables.
47% or something.
Well,
percent, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. She says basket of deplorables over here. Mm-hmm. Held to this huge standard. He insults every single group out there.
Right.
And he is below the table. You can't even see his bar anymore. Mm-hmm. It's hiding back here. Why? Mm-hmm. Why? Why are we doing this? Is it because she's a woman?
Mm-hmm.
And he's a man? And, you know, or is it Trump's saying whatever we're all thinking. If you're thinking that, just leave it in your head. You know, you shouldn't be saying these things. To me, it's like, she says one thing, basket of deplorables.
Mm-hmm.
And he says so much more. And nobody cuts him down.
Mm-hmm.
Why?
Yeah, I wonder that too.
Nobody cuts him down. Mm-hmm. It'll make the news rounds for the afternoon, and then it's over and done with, and we move on to something else. Oh, look what Hillary's doing over here. Oh, mm-hmm. We have to hold her to a higher standard, and I believe that's because it's a form of sexism. Mm-hmm. We can look at and say, you know, you're holding her to a higher standard because she's a woman.
Mm-hmm.
But you're going to hold him to a lower standard because... Yeah, he's a man. Men do this all the time. Men do this all the time. Who cares?
Yeah.
Give me a break.
Yeah, and then she has pneumonia. So there's another thing that, you know, we have to pick at.
Oh,
yeah. It's just...
There's so many conspiracy theories out there what it is. It's that. It's everything under the sun. It's like, you know, as a woman, you're a woman.
Mm-hmm.
You can look at women that have to go to work sick because who's going to, make extra money for the family?
Mm-hmm.
When my mom was sick and she had 8 kids,
mm-hmm.
and 2 of us were always home, you know, my sister and I are about a year apart, year and a half apart. When she was sick, she still took care of us.
Mm-hmm.
She was still working. You know, that was her job, was to take care of us because, you know, my dad was primary breadwinner. And... What do you think about that? You know, women have this, they can't be sick. So she mm-hmm. has to keep going on. And if she would have came out and said, oh, I'm sick,
mm-hmm.
what would it have been? Oh, she can't handle the job.
Yeah.
She can't handle the job because, oh, she's taking 2 days off because she mm-hmm. has pneumonia. Presidents can't do that. Donald Trump wouldn't do that. He would go right through and he would, you know, be the healthy as a horse. Come on. People get sick.
Yeah.
You can't, you know, you cannot, you know, not have the flu. You know, you might go a year, but next year you might get hit hard.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's just a very unfair advantage that, you know, Trump has right now over her.
Yeah.
So.
Well, and then there's also, you know, I mean, this isn't so much with Hillary, but with younger women, it's the hormonal. You know, there's that certain time that, you know, they're hormonal, so we don't want them to be in charge of any buttons that might push that might launch
a
missile
button.
Somewhere.
It's not a button.
You know,
it's codes and it's a whole laundry list of things you got to do to launch those things.
Yeah.
Give me a break.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it's hormonal. She'll when it's her time of the month, she's going to, you know, declare war on China. Really? We have a constitution. We have laws. We have regulations. You got to look at that before she can go, I'm going to declare war. And by that time, she'll be back to her old self.
Mm-hmm.
And what does it matter if someone's having, you know, hormonal time of the month? It shouldn't matter.
Yeah, it shouldn't.
So men get hormonal.
Mm-hmm.
They get hormonal.
Yeah.
So
maybe that's what's wrong with Trump.
Maybe he's just been hormonal, you know, 24/7, 365. But, you know... When you look at it, Who started all the wars?
Mm-hmm.
Men or women?
Men.
Men, mm-hmm. Exactly. So maybe we do need a woman in there so we can mm-hmm. have world peace, maybe. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's what the world needs. A whole bunch of women running the show so we have world peace finally.
Yeah.
Because the men seem to be screwing it all up right now.
Well, I know one particular man I don't want to see in there.
Yeah, yeah. And like I said, that's why I cannot in good faith vote for him. I can't. I couldn't even, you know, hope and be like, well, I'm going to vote for someone else, or I'm going to write Bernie's name in, so that mm-hmm. way, you know, it's going to show the Democratic Party. And if Trump gets in, what happens?
Yeah.
Then I'm going to have to be like, oh, I voted, and pretty much I got him in.
Yeah, exactly. So. And it's just really scary to think that this man might be in there, because I can just see this whole, you know, he reminds me of, I don't want to say that he's the second Hitler, but he reminds me of Hitler's tactics of scapegoating.
Did you see the Skittle meme that his son posted?
No.
About what if there were three, something like along the lines of, if there are three Skittles in this bowl,
mm-hmm.
would you take, that were poisonous, would you take a handful? Mm-hmm. It was referring to the Syrian refugees.
Okay.
And I can't think of the name. It was a Nazi propagandist. He wrote a book, and it was pretty much making, I think it was, what, Jews out to be mushrooms, and there could be a billion mushrooms in the world, and, you know, six of them are poisonous.
Mm-hmm.
Would you eat a mushroom? Give me a break. You know, he was using a Nazi tactic, you know, and posting that online where everyone to see, and everyone's like, yeah, I wouldn't trust that. He's using the Nazi playbook to win his election.
Yeah, and it's scary.
Oh, it's very scary.
It's scary.
Very scary.
I had a guest, and he's coming back in a couple weeks, Yasser. And Yasser is Muslim. He practices Islam. And I asked him, I said, that has to be incredibly scary. You know, as a Muslim man walking around and knowing that the potential next president is saying, well, we're going to go in the mosque and we're going to pull them out and we're going to interrogate them, because all of them know who the terrorists are. I mean, I just can't. And it's like with the LGBT community and with blacks, with some of the, I'm not going to say all the police, but with, you know, issues with certain police. It's like, it's scary to, someone would be singled out because the way they look or what.
Right. And if Trump's going to go into the mosques, so he claims,
mm-hmm.
and remove them and, you know, force them to tell you who the terrorists are, what's going to stop him from going into the black community and say, hey, who are the ones that were rioting?
Mm-hmm.
Waterboard them. Torture them. They'll tell us who the criminals are. Or go into the LGBT community and torture them just, you know, mm-hmm. because Mike Pence thinks it's funny. Mm-hmm. You know, if he's not going to stop at the Muslim community, or if he says he's only going to go with the Muslim community, what's going to stop him from going into other communities? Your community, my community, mm-hmm. any community. Because that's, you know, that's what his resolve is going to be. I'm going to make America safe by torturing us all.
Yeah. I don't even know what to say at this point. It's just so.
I don't.
It's just so out there, and I've never seen an election like this.
I hope I never see an election like this ever again. I hope this was the last one.
Me
too.
Yeah, me too. I hope it's just, and I would just love to see, some tolerance seep into our society. You know, instead of this, you know, honestly, I don't think it should be an issue as to who you're married to.
It shouldn't
be an issue. It shouldn't be an issue what your skin color is. It shouldn't be an issue
what religion you practice.
Or exactly.
Or anything of that nature.
None of that should be an issue. And it just kind of, I mean, maybe I'm naive or something, but it just boggles my mind that people are so stuck on that.
I think some people are just upset with their own lives and how their life turned out, that mm-hmm. they just got to make everyone else miserable. I think that's what it's just coming down to.
It's a scapegoating.
I think it is. I think people are just, you know, they're upset that how their life is, and I got to look for an excuse to, you know, let's, you know, ban the Muslims because, mm-hmm. you know, my life sucks. Let's, you know, immigration is going out of control. Let's build a wall and, you know, kick all the illegals out. We've already, economists have already looked at that and said, if you do that, our economy is going to go, you know, in the toilet quick.
Right.
Because it's going to, $14 billion is going to be removed from our economy overnight mm-hmm. if you were to do that. Who's going to do those jobs? You know, we have to update our immigration system.
Mm-hmm.
I've heard horror stories of the immigration system, and it just, instead of saying build a wall and let's ignore it, how about we look at our immigration system and mm-hmm. go, maybe we need to fix that, and then the illegal immigration will you know, subside or mm-hmm. lower, lessen itself. Maybe we should focus on other things instead of the easy way. Let's just build a wall and be done with it.
Yeah. Well, I have to say the last time that when you and Glenn were on, and after the show, I had discussions with different
right.
people. And, you know, one of the things that stuck with me was when you talked about having people that were your friend, and then when they found out that you're gay,
they treat you different, or
they
just gradually stop talking to you.
Yeah.
So yeah, it happens.
And that just really, I mean, that just really stuck with me because I'm thinking, you know, you're such a great guy.
Well, it just shows you who your real friends are.
Yeah.
Are they going to stick with you over one small thing, or are they going to be like, oh, I don't want to deal with that. That's weird. And you're lost. I sleep fine at night.
Yeah.
So I don't, you know, I don't freak out. I do know you did send me an email about, you wanted to ask about how individuals, you know, the importance of coming out.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it's important or if it's just so much that it's a personal choice.
Mm-hmm.
Like with me, I was like, well, I'm an open book. You can ask me any question. I'll tell you any answer. You may not like the answer, but whatever. And to me, it was like, you know, I'm not going to live secret. I'm not going to, mm-hmm. you know, have my friends over here. And then they're like, oh, you're not dating anyone. Yeah, I'm not dating anyone. But I got to go home. It's getting late. And it's like mm-hmm. 7 o'clock and run out and, you know, have a date. There are some people that I know that have never said, yeah, I'm gay.
Mm-hmm.
Or, yeah, I'm a lesbian. You know, you know, just them talking, but it's, you know, they'd never officially, quote, come out. I mean, I work with a couple that are like, yeah, you know, I'm just never come out. Mm-hmm. Just don't really see the need for it. All right, that's, you know, that's on you. It's always a personal choice if you're going to come out or not. Do I encourage you to come out? Yeah, I would come out. You know, it's easier. It's very opening. It's very
liberating.
Liberating. That's mm-hmm. the word I'm looking for. And you can finally just say, "Hey, I'm gay. Be done with it," and mm-hmm. then move on with your life.
Yeah.
Instead of always having to worry, do I think that they know? Do they know? Do they know? What if they don't like me? You know, if they don't like you, they don't like you. Move on.
Well, that question actually came, and I didn't put this in the email, but the reason I asked you that question was because I was in a discussion with a couple of people, and they were talking about, and I won't name the politician, but there was a politician that basically one of the other people in the group that I was talking to said that it's like the best kept, worst kept secret that this individual is gay, and they just they vote against all gay legislation. They want nothing to do with it.
People hate themselves for it,
yeah.
because society has made it
mm-hmm.
A bad thing. It's a bad thing that, you know, you're holding hands with another man. It's a bad thing mm-hmm. that you're married to a man. It's a bad thing that you have, here's a bad word, sex with mm-hmm. another man. You know, society has made it so terrible. But when you think about it, it's, to me, it's normal. To
mm-hmm.
me, that because that's just, you know, who I am and how I am. To me, it's normal. Society shouldn't get to dictate what normal is.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, and with, you know, religion and things of that nature, who say, you know, and there are some religious entities out there that, you know, are like, no, we're open and affirming, and you know, whatever your
mm-hmm.
your path in life is, come join us. We don't care. We don't judge. Which, that's how all religion should be.
Mm-hmm.
Just putting that out there. But, you know, some religions are look at the Westboro Baptist. Mm-hmm. They, you know, they protest soldiers, they protest gays, they protest all like just anyone if they want. You know, and they make it, they vilify it so terribly, and mm-hmm. people are like, if they're vilifying me, you know, if they know that I'm gay, they're going to vilify me, and I'm not strong enough for it. A lot of people aren't strong enough to handle that. Mm-hmm. I've been called, you know, every stereotypical gay insult in the book, and I have tough skin for it, so you can call me whatever you want, and mm-hmm. I'll look at you and wave and say, hi. Because I think that drives people insane mm-hmm. more, because mm-hmm. they think I'm going to run away and cry.
Yeah.
But if I'm like, hi, how are you? You know, mm-hmm. they're like, wait, I just called you a, yeah, you did, and I don't care. You look like an idiot.
Are you supporting Trump?
Yeah, he was usually one of the ones that have, like, Make America Great Again.
Yeah.
Oh, I hate that slogan. Oh, I hate that slogan. Make America Great.
Yeah.
You know, you have Colin Kaepernick, who kneels at a national anthem saying that America is not great, mm-hmm. and everyone is vilifying him. Mm-hmm. And yet Donald Trump is saying, Make America Great Again, implying that America is not great, and he's the Republican nominee.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I hate that slogan. I'm like, how? What is that? What is that? And it's like, oh, one's black, one's white. That explains white privilege right there.
Mm-hmm.
What if, you know, that's one thing right there that you can say, that does explain white privilege.
Mm-hmm.
That we're going to look at a white guy and say, yeah, we need to make America great. But the black guy says it, nope, America's bad. Or America's not bad. It's the awesome, it's the greatest thing in the world. Mm-hmm. You're the bad one.
Yeah, I have a friend who got so irritated with that. You know, we're going to make it great again. We're going to make it great again. That she did a whole blog, and it was wonderful. And I told her she should submit it to one of the papers as an editorial or a letter to the editor or something. And she basically went back and she said, oh, make it great again, like when women had to be barefoot and pregnant, and
yep.
make it great when we lynched black people, and
yep.
make it great when, you know,
I'm just wondering, you know, his make America great, how far back are we going? Are we
yeah.
going maybe oh my just God. To... You know, maybe the 60s mm-hmm. or the 50s? Are we going, like, full bore, like, 1776, where women are barefoot and pregnant and, you know, can't vote and can barely own property, you know, things of that nature? Where are we going with this, Trump?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, maybe we should go back to the 60s and he should maybe just puff a little wacky weed or something
no.
to mellow him out. You know,
no.
he's like so...
I don't know if that'll mellow him out.
Yeah, I don't know either, but, you know, at this point, anything's worth a try.
I don't know. This election is just, I'm over it already.
Mm-hmm.
I want it to be November 9th, and
mm-hmm.
everything goes back to normal, and hopefully Trump won't win, and hopefully we won't hear Trump ever again. He'll
mm-hmm.
just kind of fall off, you know, the celebrity list, and we'll be like, Trump who?
Yeah. I think we're all hoping for that.
No, there are some people that are not hoping for that.
Mm.
There are some people that are his loudest
oh,
and biggest cheerleader, and
yeah.
I think they will probably commit suicide on November 9th if he is not the president.
Yeah.
I think our population will probably dip, you know, 30 million people.
Well, who knows? But
who knows?
Yeah, it's just a giant mess at this point.
It is.
And, yeah, and... I don't know what the answer is.
I don't think there is a right answer.
Yeah. I think it's you know, like you said, you and Glenn last time, you said, why can't we just hug each other and just be, you know, be nice to each other and
sing kumbaya like, around the campfire.
Yeah, exactly. Why not? I mean, it's so much better than all this hate mongering and
yeah.
and, you know, downing someone because they're different. So, you know.
There is no answer.
Yeah.
There is no answer. I think, you know, the hatred will just eventually breed itself out.
Mm-hmm.
I think we're eventually seeing that where the younger generation, they're no longer the as hate-filled as
mm-hmm.
the generation before them or the generation before them. I think it's going to just eventually just die itself out and, you know, everything will just be, you know, the norm almost.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, Ace, what are we down to, like, 2 minutes? 1 minute.
1 minute.
Oh, wow. We're down to one minute.
We need to sing Kumbaya.
So, yeah, we didn't even get any answers. So, thank you, Mike, for coming again. And
maybe next time Glenn will show up,
yeah,
too,
Glenn,
and we'll make it
yeah.
really interesting because I'm
yeah.
just boring.
Yeah. No, you're not. No, I you know, I'm so
gonna
happy
get complaints.
When you're coming. Yeah. Well, they'll complain about me, too.
Yeah, probably.
We done? Oh, we're not done. Oh. Ace is over there like, yep, no, yes, no. We're all kind of just counting it down today.
I think we're about almost 30 seconds left.
30 seconds yet. Okay, well, next week we're going to have, I'm going to have Carla Christopher on, who's, for those of you who don't know, she's a community advocate, and she's into everything. And we're going to do the race relations. So I think next week will be a good show. And Ace is still, go talk, talk, talk.
15 seconds.
Oh, and Ace is going to be, what are you going to be in that commercial? He's going to be in a commercial for the haunted house for the Revolutions.
Stadium.
Yeah, and he's been doing a lot of...
Hi folks, I'm Steve Butler. Welcome to the garage. This project, we're going to build these little